My name is Tom Lindsay. I direct the Center for Higher Education here at the Texas Public Policy Foundation. I'd like to welcome you to our panel, Tuition Set-Asides, Who Foots the Bill? We're honored today to have four distinguished panelists with us. Let me do the introductions now before we ask our panelists to make their initial remarks. To my immediate right is Senator Kel Seliger. Elected in 2004, Senator Seliger currently serves as the chairman of the Senate Higher Education Committee, and he is also a member of the Senate Education Committee, the Senate Finance Committee, the Senate Committee on Natural Resources and Economic Development, the Senate Committee on Business Commerce, and the Senate Committee on Government Facilities. Prior to his election to the Senate, Senator Seliger served four terms as the mayor of Amarillo and as a member of the Amarillo City Commission and the Amarillo Civil Service Commission. Moreover, congratulations are in order, Senator. Just yesterday, Senator Seliger was named the Senate President Pro Tem. Now, as outlined in the Texas Constitution, the Senate President Pro Tem performs the duties of the Lieutenant Governor in his or her absence. Also, Texas has a more than 60-year-old tradition in which the Senate President Pro Tem is sworn in as governor for a day. Congratulations, Senator Seliger.
Thank you very much.
To Senator Seliger's immediate right is John Caliandro. John serves on the board and as president of Texans for Education Opportunity. He is also the executive director of the Texas Conservative Coalition Research Institute and the executive director of the Texas Conservative Coalition, a legislative caucus. Previously, John served as director of policy and research for Greg Abbott's campaign for governor in 2014 and as director of policy for Greg Abbott's campaign for attorney general in 2002. John is a gubernatorial appointee to the Health and Human Services Commission Transition Legislative Oversight Committee. A graduate of the University of Texas at Austin, he formerly served as a major in the Texas State Guard assigned to headquarters at Camp Mabry in Austin. Welcome, John. To John's immediate right is Dr. Richard Vedder. He's the director of the Center for College Affordability and Productivity. He is a distinguished professor of economics emeritus at Ohio University, where he is in his 52nd year of teaching. That's quite an accomplishment in itself. He's the author of Going Broke by Degree, Why College Costs Too Much, and numerous other books. Dr. Vedder also served on the Spellings Commission on the Future of Higher Education. He is a graduate of Northwestern University and the University of Illinois. To the far right, last but not least, Dr. Ronald Trowbridge. Dr. Trowbridge was Director of Educational and Cultural Affairs at the United States Information Agency, directing the Fulbright Program, which required U.S. Senate confirmation for that position. Later, Dr. Trowbridge became Chief of Staff for U.S. Supreme Court Chief Justice Warren Burger. And out of that experience, he published a book on the Chief Justice. Ron holds a PhD in English from the University of Michigan, where he taught for several years. He became a tenured professor at Eastern Michigan University and later a vice president at Hillsdale College. Welcome, Ron. I'm going to just provide a very brief background of tuition set-asides and then let our esteemed panelists present their remarks. As some of you may already know, the Texas legislature passed HB 3015 in 2003, which deregulated tuition and simultaneously enacted requirements that all Texas public universities set aside a certain amount of every student's tuition each semester in order to fund needs-based financial assistance for Texas residents. Under the bill, 15% of graduate and undergraduate designated tuition that exceeds $46 per semester credit hour is set aside and goes to the university's tuition grant account. Under the original bill, another 5% is set aside for undergraduate designated tuition to fund the Texas Beyond Time program, which was limited last session by HB 1. And now we will begin with Senator Seliger. Senator?
Thank you very much.
In an unrelated issue, has anyone ever noticed that these look a lot of things like the things that you hold below you on a mugshot? No personal experience there, just observation. Set-asides are just part of the discussion of higher education. Not an unimportant part, but they're part of that discussion. And the relevance of that discussion is a profound one. We talk a lot about we would like by 2030, 60% of all Texas citizens to have a certificate or a diploma, and that's very important. And while that being the case, we would like everyone to have that opportunity if they have the ability or aspiration. But then it brings up questions of accessibility and affordability, and it's very, very important. Sometimes we get sidetracked by discussions that say, well, all college ought to be free. It's not going to happen. And that there should be no debt associated. We need to have a discussion about the merits of that discussion, but there are a lot of different elements to it. What about set-asides? And this came from a discussion with the Lieutenant Governor, and actually, what are set-asides? And you think, and you'd say, well, 15% is not a bad idea. What does it really do, and what does it really mean? And quantitatively, it means very little at all. And the reason is because that 15% from student A that goes to the tuition of student B does not indicate more money going to that institution. If there were no set-aside, it would be the same amount of dollars paid to the university by student A and by student B. It may change, it may shuffle the deck in terms of how scholarship monies are allocated, but it doesn't change the net amount of money that goes to the university. The discussion also assumes that everyone who is student A is somehow a wealthy student or parents or who are comfortable. Are we then taking scholarship money then from kids whose parents can easily afford college? And I think not. And so what are we really talking about? What I've described as sort of an accounting device. So does if we take away set-asides, then does the university get either more or less money? No, not a bit. It's the same amount of money. And let's say a university, a particularly well-heeled one, where almost everybody gets a scholarship, and set-aside says that they get 15%. What if that university wants to spend 20%? Well, they're perfectly free to do that. And without set-asides, if they like that 15% number, they can continue it at the discretion of the university. And so set-asides are more symbolic, in my view, and I'm particularly interested in Mr. Vedder and Dr. Trowbridge's attitude, but to me, they're an accounting device. They are great. They are great when it comes to a demonstration that that the state wants to help students and things like that, and most of the people I know really do, but substantively, does it do a lot? Not a lot. We need to have that discussion in light of all the other discussions that we have about affordability and accessibility to the students. And I think this is going to be a really good session for it. I think it's a bill that is going to have a lot of support. And it's going to be interesting to hear the arguments when people say, we shouldn't do away with them. Why not? Really, empirically and quantitatively, what does it do? If we do away with set-asides, and I would argue at this stage in the way they exist, does very little or nothing.
Thank you, Senator Seliger. We'll next hear from John Caliendro.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Appreciate being here with Senator Seliger, especially for his excellent work as chairman of the committee. One brief fact before I get into point of view, two brief facts. First of all, in 2013-14, set-asides were used to fund over $172 million in aid to about 85,000 students attending four-year institutions. Undergraduate set-asides in 2012 were funded, in 2004, after the legislature passed a bill in 2003 permitting set-asides, the set-asides cost $2.55 per semester hour. 10 years later, There are now $19.18, which doesn't sound like much, but that's an increase of over 650% since set-asides have been allowed by state law. There are three aspects to tuition set-asides that I think are particularly important, and they are all essentially an argument against having the set-asides. First of all, we've had an ongoing debate here in Texas and nationally about the dramatic increases in tuition and the cost of higher education generally. Numerous studies have shown that government subsidies and subsidized student loans are a significant factor in the growth of those costs. For example, the Federal Reserve Bank of New York found that for every additional dollar in subsidized loans, colleges raised tuition by roughly 65 cents. Another study compared private colleges that accepted financial federal aid assisted students to those who did not and found that prices were approximately 75% higher among those institutions that accepted federally assisted students. Set-asides affect the cost of tuition. As a publication put out by the Texas Comptroller pointed out, quote, "There are multiple potential explanations for the steep rise in the cost of higher education. The use of tuition set-asides is hardly the only reason, but it is a reason." Governor Patrick has made this an interim charge for the Senator's Committee, certainly at your request, presumably. I apologize for not knowing in advance, but at the Senator's request. And we have to understand that as Milton Friedman, who these gentlemen almost certainly have known in their professional careers, it is an elementary fact that that businesses do not and cannot pay taxes. Only people pay taxes. And in this sense, set-asides are just like a tax. They are absorbed by the individual, and it's a cost shifting of a pretty significant degree. To illustrate the point, for, as the Senator pointed out, there's sort of this prevailing conventional wisdom that the student who is paying the set-aside is somehow wealthy, that they're all upper income, maybe to use the terminology of the progressive left, that maybe they're all one percenters. That is certainly not true. And to the extent it's not true, here's where the cost shifting becomes a problem. If we accept that the higher education is extremely expensive and the cost is growing, this is what it means. And this is an example I can use because this fit my situation. When I was at the University of Texas, I had to work. A student earning minimum wage, and that's actually more than what typically a waiter or waitress at a restaurant would make because you have tips included. If you made the minimum wage, you worked 20 hours a week, it would take you nearly 3.5 weeks to pay for your cost of the set-aside. That's a significant cost shift in the same vein that taxation is a cost shift. Eliminating set-asides could address this government-induced inflation in higher education. If the legislature eliminates the set-asides, it will take time for the costs to work their way out of the system, but nonetheless, those cost shifts will happen. The main cost shifting argument is an objection to one group of students being charged extra in order to fund education for another group of students. If there is a social good in subsidizing education, putting aside the cost of the problem of inflation in higher education, if there is nonetheless a social good, then the legislature should fund that the equivalent amount of set-asides through general revenue. It makes no sense to increase the cost of one student's education to the benefit of another. That is especially true in the broader context of how much money is available for student loans, grants, and other subsidies for higher education. So for context, students enrolled in Texas institutions of higher education in 2013-14 and who applied for need-based assistance received a total of $9.43 billion in aid. Of this $9.4 billion in student financial aid, almost half is in the form of grants that do not have to be repaid. That is an extraordinary amount of money, of which tuition set-asides is a mere drop in the bucket at $172 million. So to wrap up the my brief remarks here, there's something right and noble to making college education affordable. Making it unaffordable by inducing inflation and cost shifting from one set of students to another is not right and noble. Academically qualified candidates should have the opportunity to enroll in post-secondary work, but then if that is the case, then why not fund financial assistance programs for those who want and need them entirely through general revenue than through the practice of tuition set-asides? Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. We'll next hear from Rich Vedder.
I think I'm going to come up there, John. That light is bothering me. I don't know. Does anyone have a BB gun? I'm going to go to first principles here. Let's talk about prices. That's what a tuition fee is. The price mechanism for allocating resources among scarce uses in the competitive market economy has worked so powerfully in our nation to make us the richest nation in the world. Government efforts to interfere with that price mechanism, naturally, almost always have unintended consequences. Minimum wage, my best friend. Minimum wage laws are designed to raise the price of labor, but they cause unemployment among minorities and vulnerable unskilled workers. Rent controls are designed to lower the price of housing, but they lead to shortages and declines in quality. It's true that in higher education, government impacts both the supply and demand by its subsidies and regulations, which distorts prices from what they would be if they were determined solely by human action. And that, theoretically at least, opens the door for at least some controlling of prices by governments that might reduce distortions. With that in mind, many states, including Texas before 2003, put some constraints on the ability of universities to raise fees. In some states, the legislature mandates tuition freeze or maximum tuition growth rates. In others, a state governing board, similar to the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board, sets the fees. As Tom indicated in his introduction, in 2003, Texas gave schools greater freedom to raise fees, but did something that, to my knowledge, has never been done anywhere else in the United States. It imposed a large tuition set-aside for scholarship assistance. When Tom asked me to speak about tuition set-asides, I said, what the hell are they? I never heard of them. I've only written several books and 100 articles on higher ed. I never heard of them. For Texans, however, the average discount in-state tuition fee at state schools is 80-85% of the published in-state tuition fees. There is a tax, 15%, 20%, I'm not sure which, but it is a tax and it's used to redistribute income. Take from the so-called affluent kids, who are not all affluent, and give to the poorer ones. Robin Hood comes to campus. Another friend. Now, the reason I suspect that Texas is unique with its set-aside program is that it's absolutely a bizarre policy, in my judgment. If you want to redistribute income from the rich to the poor, which I am not either advocating for or against today, that's not what we're here for, the appropriate thing to do is have the politicians, through the political process, give payments or in-time goods or services to low-income persons, not turning that task over to university admissions officials and financial aid offices, where unelected bureaucrats can capriciously make non-uniform decisions on the distribution of aid. As in other states, Texas universities are not sinful, free of sin when it comes to making, showing favorites and making admissions and financial aid decisions. So when Texas mandates a tuition tax increase, it does have an impact on raising published fees. Now, I appreciate what the senator said, and I find it very interesting. It's really, in some ways, much ado about nothing. I heard a number of $172 million mentioned. That got me thinking. Texas is unique in one respect in higher ed. No other state could say this. It has its two largest universities have extremely large endowments thanks to God and the Texas Constitution, in that order. If it were mandated that 50% of the University of Texas's endowment income were to be used to offer free tuition at the flagship campus here in Austin, then with reasonable policies regarding payouts from the UT endowment, every native Texan attending the Austin campus could go free, zero tuition. Now, the university has chosen, and maybe some of this is mandated by statute, but it has chosen to use its endowment funds otherwise, perhaps to construct elaborate facilities, to support large administrative staffs, to pay large salaries, or to give professors like me low teaching loads so they can publish articles in the Journal of Last Resort. Now, Texas A&M has a smaller but still outsized endowment, much larger than any other public university in the United States, and it could do much of the same thing. It chooses not to, and if I were in the legislature, a laughable thought, I would be comparing tuition and spending at these schools and other schools with those in other states, just to see if there are anomalies. I think, indeed, some research, perhaps it should be done by researchers outside the state of Texas, should answer the following questions. Have tuition fees in Texas, since set-asides began, risen more than in other states? Is there any hard evidence that set-asides have sizably increased the proportion of young adult Texans with college degrees, particularly those from low-income groups? How do tuition fees at Texas schools compared with those in neighboring states? And I'm now going to get in really deep trouble, but I have tenure and I don't really give a damn. For all the talk about having top-flight universities and with the existence of these massive endowments, why aren't the very top Texas schools, why don't they surpass the flagship state universities in other states in the national magazine rankings and so forth, schools with much smaller endowments, schools like the University of Michigan, the University of North Carolina, or even the University of California. The question that comes to my mind is Texas getting enough bang for its buck? I'm not answering the question, I'm merely asking it. So, have you thought about abolishing set-asides, lowering published tuition rates, or have you thought about using those funds to reduce and other funds to reduce university appropriations, but offer a statewide voucher system, similar to a Pell Grant that goes directly to the students, similar to the Pell Grant, which is based on income? There are all sorts of ways, in other words, that you can reach outside of the current mechanism to help lower income people. You perhaps should have considered some alternative programs and the like. But I think my time, and Tom is religious about wanting to keep this thing on schedule. I'm an academic, we don't pay attention to any sort of resource constraints whatsoever, but I understand you do here.
Thank you, Dr. Vedder. And last but certainly not least, Dr. Trowbridge.
I'm not going to talk.
Thank God.
Yeah, I know. He's nuts. But it helps. He's professor. It's an oxymoron. I want to act like Justice, Supreme Court Justice Anthony Kennedy on this one. Anthony Kennedy always speaks on both sides of the issue. And you never know what side he's going to come down on. So my position here tonight is going to be, like Kennedy, bipolar. I'm going to talk on both sides of the issue. The tuition set aside Robin Hood formula is another way of asking, are there moral and economic grounds for
you KGB? This is Russian. He's Russian. What was that talking about?
No.
Are there moral and economic grounds for redistribution of income? That's what this is about. Yes, there has to be. Otherwise, there would be no federal or state governments. All governments redistribute income. They do not make money. They only collect it and redistribute it. Literally, all governments can be boiled down to two paradoxical words: coerced charity. Democrats tend to redistribute income or charity to serve their own interests, for such as social programs and social justice. Republicans, too, do the same thing for their own interests, for such as stronger military or stronger economic development. These parties do not fight over the concept of charity or redistribution of income. Rather, they fight over the recipients of it. I want to cite two examples of needed charity at Lone Star College, where I am a trustee. Believe me, we have 100,000 students. I could give you thousands of examples. Thousands of examples. I'll give you just two. One student, whom I'll call Mary, wrote us a 2,000-word thank you letter for her scholarship, reporting, among many other struggles, quote, "My house was a little shack with walls made out of cardboard, pieces of metal, and scrap wood. On rainy days, the rain would come through the ceiling, and I would have to sleep on the edge of my bed trying to stay dry." Later, she reports in that thank you letter to us, "My mom and I would walk for miles to town, to the town dump, to pick through the produce trash for vegetables and fruits that we could eat. We helped Mary. We gave her some money. She got an associate's degree. She later got a BA degree, and she's now a successful businesswoman and productive member of society, paying society back." One other case, another student whom I'll call Sarah, wrote us a thank you letter saying that her scholarship came at an especially needed time because her family had spent lots of money treating her mother's stage 3 cancer. "My wife died of cancer, so I call students where there's cancer in the family. Generally, we tend to avoid people like that because we don't know what to say to them. I called this girl. I called Sarah, only to be told that her mother's cancer had now metastasized to terminal 4. And I said to Sarah, she would have to go through what my own daughter had to go through when she lost her mother. I said, promise me that you will one day return to Lone Star and finish your education. 1 week before this past fall's term began, Sarah called me and said, "Mom died Tuesday, but I want you to know I'm coming back to school. Could I possibly," they were broke, "could I possibly apply for a scholarship?" I immediately called Chancellor Steve Head and asked, "Is there any way we can help Sarah? She's suffered enough." The chancellor immediately contacted her, saying that the college would pick up her tuition, fees, and books for the full semester. These two students illustrate a microcosm within a macrocosm and the need and good use of redistribution of income. In a way, theirs is a restatement of the tuition set aside and redistribution issue. It is easy to make the case for Mary and Sarah on both moral and economic grounds. They will pay back society, as will thousands of other community college graduates. Now, I want to finish with one other point, and this is maybe the most important thing I'm going to say. There remains a crucial fact to emphasize. Empirical evidence documents that relatively wealthy students at universities already receive far more than their fair share of subsidy, of redistribution of income, of charity. Research findings published by the American Enterprise Institute, titled "Cheap for Whom?", document this unfair disparity between rich and poor college students. Most of the money goes to the rich kids, most of it. They reveal, and I'm going to quote these statistics, who did this study. Among not-for-profit institutions, the amount of taxpayer subsidy hovers between $1 and $2,000 per student per year. I know that's the case where I am at Lone Star College. Until we turn to the most selective institutions, and you've heard from Richard in his moments of sanity that UT has an endowment of at least $26 billion. It is the richest public school in the world by far. Anyway, the average kid at a low-income college gets $1,000 to $2,000 a year. Until we turn to the most selective institutions, among these already well-endowed institutions, the tax subsidy jumps substantially to more than $13,000 per student per year. I finish with this. Terminating tuition set-asides would widen the disparity between rich and poor students. And it's going to be up to Senator Seliger and his colleagues as to how they will address this disparity.
Thank you, Dr. Trowbridge. Before we turn to your questions in the audience, I'd like you all to join me in thanking all four of our panelists. And before we do turn it to the audience, I want to give if any of you had any additional remarks that you wanted to make.
I'd like to pick up on Ron's last point. It's an absolutely true. By the way, I'm also work for the American Enterprise Institute, so which put out that study. You didn't know that, Ron. You know, I do other things. If you compare Princeton University with the College of New Jersey, which used to be called Trenton State College, it is a state university. Princeton University is a private university, so-called private university. Trenton State College is a public institution. Trenton State College, now College of New Jersey, gets $2,000, $3,000 a student in some form of government money or other Princeton gets $75,000 to $100,000 a student. A lot of it's research money. A lot of it is tax preferences on endowments. And the tax preferences on endowment is something at work. So there is an enormous amount of disparity in higher education that needs to be addressed, that go way beyond tax. A lot of it's federal to begin with, and a lot of it goes beyond tuition tax sides. And I do think you need to look at your policies on that. We need to look at things such as endowments. If we're really interested in looking at higher education as an instrument for equal opportunity. Last thing on this, though, is we have a significant, and this is heresy to say, and it goes against what the senator said, and I love you, Senator, but I disagree with you, on this one minor point. Why do we say 60% of students should have a certain degree by a certain year? How do we know that? The reality is that there's a whole variety of data from the New York Federal Reserve Bank that shows that between 40 and 50% of recent college graduates are doing jobs that high school graduates have traditionally done. They are the proverbial Uber drivers, except in Austin, where I guess it's illegal. You get executed for driving for Uber in Austin. They're you know, baristas and home health care aides and drive trucks. I have nothing against these occupations, but should the public be subsidizing this? So I think we should ask, are we overinvested or underinvested in higher ed? I think it's a legitimate question.
I have brief aside having to do with Dr. Trowbridge's point that has nothing to do with Mr. Vedder's sanity. That was Dr. Trowbridge's comment, not mine.
Thank you.
And that is it correct to say that when you talk about closing that gap, Dr. Trowbridge, that we have the facility to do that and use it to an extent, that being the Texas Grant Program. Over $750 million. That has been refined over the years, so it no longer plays for that fifth-year victory lap. It is need-based to ensure that students who need it are the ones who get it, and I think it's worked very well for our students.
What'd you say?
Well, the question's to you. I don't know anything about it. It sounds cool to me.
It is a simple scholarship program.
Yeah, it's equivalent to a Pell Grant-type program.
Well, yeah. Okay,
again,
and here's one of the problems that in my understanding with Pell Grants is they can be spent for anything. Mm-hmm. Beer and pizza, what a great deal. Yeah. Subsidized beer and pizza.
And there's no academic standards whatsoever. And there is nothing wrong with asking to have some standards when you give money to kids.
Sir. And we do that with the Texas grants. They've got to be spent on things that are academically relevant. I think that's good. We have a lot of work to do, as Dr. Trowbridge points out.
Our kids get Pell Grants.
Right.
A lot of them get Pell Grants. The only requirement is that you must be breathing. That's the degree of subtlety. You've got to be alive to qualify. And a lot of our kids do. I think about 60% of our kids.
60% breathe.
All right, thank you. We're now happy to entertain any questions from the audience. And please raise your hand, and we'll come over here with the wireless microphone. And if you'll simply state your name and your affiliation, we'll just start in the front here.
Hi, I'm Sean Johnson. I am an attorney and CPA, and I founded Stop Texas Set-Asides in 2010. We know that students who use loans to pay for their entire tuition also have their tuition set aside. That means that those students wind up paying interest on those set-aside dollars. So my question is, what prevents the needy students receiving those dollars from obtaining loans so that they have some skin in the game, so to speak? And shouldn't that be the policy where all of the students have skin in the game to incentivize them to graduate on time, get degrees that they can use to then go pay back those loans. Thank you.
Your question is, what keeps them from doing that? I don't think anything does, just as it has to be addressed as a matter of policy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the students that were, some students are paying interest on these loans, but there's nothing that's preventing the students receiving those dollars from just taking out their own loans and paying them back, so to speak.
Right.
Okay.
We'll go to the next person, second row here.
Should the federal government be willing to grant a certain amount of money to Texas, say, for the total education program, both in the K through 12 and college? Do you think that would lead to greater efficiency in terms of price to the government?
Miss, are you directing this question to anyone in particular or the whole group? Go ahead.
My view and answer is no. That's what you call the Medicaid program, and has greatly distorted pricing in that marketplace as well, and has diminished outcomes for the persons on Medicaid. You'd have the same thing. But more directly to your point, as these gentlemen pointed out, with Pell Grants and other subsidy programs that already exist at the federal level, you have that input. The state of Texas or institutions in the state of Texas will receive quite a bit of research money, as an example, from the federal government. So there's substantial involvement already that has implications here. And as I pointed out in my remarks, there is about $9 billion that's available. A lot of that is probably about 75% of it is federally related loans and other programs.
If you could take out the federal government regulations, wouldn't you save some money? And I mean, if nothing else, for the overcost, federal overcost.
That's never going to happen. Well, just, you heard Hager today say that they have roughly $100 billion from the general fund, but they have another $100 billion from the government. I promise you, they're not going to push that aside.
I agree, and I think you're asking a legitimate question. Right. And the question is, it's the question of federalism, really. Right. So what is the role that the federal government should be playing in these education programs? Historically, they played no role, particularly at the higher ed role. Before the Morrell Act, there's a few minor things, but trivial government involvement in higher education before 1960, till before the GI Bill, trivial government involvement. And if you look at the government involvement in higher education since the Department of Education was created in 1980, and I just testified before a U.S. Senate committee on this, I think, on balance, higher education has gone downhill. And not dramatically, but it has not, it isn't as good today as it was 35 years ago by a lot of criteria to measure this. We're even starting to lose our advantage vis-a-vis other countries, starting to. And the reason is I think the beauty of the federal system is the state governments, first of all, they know what's going on in their states better. And secondly, the competition of letting each state battle it out works beautifully if the government just stays out of the role. Now, if they drop money out of airplanes over Austin, the thoughts of that is mind-boggling to me. Here we have a federal government who borrows $500 billion a year because it can't pay its own bills, borrows it mainly from foreign investors. So what would be happening is we're borrowing money from Chinese investors so that we can give it to people in Texas to be used by politicians however they want. I don't see any particular advantages to that. My solution would be, if I were a czar, is get the government out of the business, federal government.
Yeah, but
I guess I have a pet peeve first. I live in College Station, Texas, we're moving toward 90,000 students. We have students that protest harsh immigration laws, and they go to Texas A&M free and are able to pursue a degree that they want to have and at no cost to them. We have other kids. I had a personal trainer. It took him 5 years to get out of an undergraduate degree because he worked two jobs. His dad was a retired Dallas PD, and there was no money left by the time number six, which was this man. I have huge respect for the one and total disrespect for the other. I believe that when we have Uber drivers with advanced degrees, it tells us there were people that went to college that didn't deserve to be there because they don't have the drive to work from the bottom up. They want $150,000 a year salary as starting pay, and if they don't get it, they just stay in school, and they just run up more and more and more debt. And, you know, I was born in 1954 to a tenant cotton farmer, and we worked the fields when we needed to, and we paid for our own college, and we managed to get it done. So, if you know, I think in today's society, if they're not willing to pay for their own college, they shouldn't go, plain and simple. Because whatever you do yourself and you earn yourself, you respect a lot more than when it's handed to you. So what do you guys think about my story?
It's interesting. What role does the government play in higher ed? Right before he died, I wrote Milton Friedman, and I asked him that.
Is that why he died?
I've been accused of many things, but never of murdering Milton Friedman.
Post hoc, ergo propter hoc.
The Milton Friedman in Capitalism and Freedom said there's one area where government involvement makes sense, and that's higher education, because there's all these positive spillover effects of universities. And therefore, they need to be subsidized in some fashion. I wrote him shortly before he died, as I indicated, and I said, Dr. Friedman, do you still believe that? He said, well, there's some what we call in economics positive externalities. There's some positive spillover effects from higher ed, but there are negative ones too. And he says it would be an interesting empirical investigation into whether, at the moment, whether we should be taxing universities or subsidizing them. And so Friedman's point of view had changed radically. And I do think every now and then we need to sit and ask first principles again. Are we doing the right thing by our public subsidy programs for universities? I think we all are people of goodwill, and I think Center's a person of goodwill. I think everyone's a good people of goodwill. But there are unintended consequences of some of these policies that are not fully recognized.
Yes.
Thank you to all the panelists. It's a lot of great information. My question is more about what legislative action we might see this legislative session on this issue. And since the tuition deregulation in 2003, do you think they'll be a gradual take back of that and some tuition regulation coming on? And would that address this and therefore reduce the tuition set asides? What legislative action might we see now?
Thank you for asking. There will be the bill to do away with set asides, and there will be a bill to go back and readdress the issue. The way I think we ought to deal with regulation, and we should, is with performance-based increases above inflation over which there is no effect. There was the bill didn't pass in the last legislature, passed the Senate, was held up in the House of Representatives, and its absence, then universities were perfectly free to raise tuition with whatever justifications or none that they chose to invoke. What my bill did was to say that after a certain period of time above the rate of inflation, for which no university can or any entity can be blamed, that they had to show progress in a number of areas out of a broad spectrum of them in order to raise tuition additionally to that, and then it was nominal. And they were things like total undergraduate degrees in six-year graduation rates, 30-year, 60, 90-hour completion progress with at-risk students, average length of time to earn a degree, and the percentage of administrative costs as a percentage of total costs. And as we see things increase, those instructional costs as opposed to administrative costs, it gets skewed more when you talk about system costs where no students are, where no research is done, no students are taught, and no degrees are granted. And so, yes, we're going to see some legislation. It'll be an interesting and very robust debate.
Yes. If I may,
please.
May I add to that for a second? Since you raised the issue of tuition deregulation, it very much relates to this, not just from the fundamental fact that it was part of the same legislation a decade ago, but just the simple economic reality. When we talk about deregulation of prices, and we think of classic cases like freight lines and airlines and so forth, there is a genuine marketplace in this respect that airline doesn't have a direct subsidy in a certain respect related to ticket prices and so forth. Obviously, they are able to take advantage of the federal government's involvement in building airports and those types of things. But just as a fundamental matter, there's no direct subsidy. It's a complete misnomer to say that there is a market in a genuine sense for pricing at universities. And I think that's Dr. Vedder's one of his basic points. So when we said the universities charge whatever you think is necessary, it was done in the context, in the knowing context, of the massive amount of subsidies that were already in the system. The University of Texas's endowment 10 years ago was already enormous, and it's just bigger today. And what has happened over the course of the time is, as in that decade, as we've seen these price increases, the response on the part of the universities is to argue for more subsidy, knowing full well that they could get away with both price increases and benefit from the subsidies that are passed in the name of those price increases. So we've had this ratcheting up in prices overall, and it all goes back to the fundamental premise here, which is the subsidies. We may be well over-subsidized in higher education, to the point of which it becomes unaffordable from a tax perspective or an individual's perspective, and you lead to a lot of people in universities that are benefiting from this. But to what extent does we have these external benefits? Sometimes it's difficult to understand.
Yes, sir. My question for Senator Seliger, I have a question for Senator Seliger and a quick one for Mr. Vedder as well. For the senator, it's probably too late to do anything along the lines of what he was talking about with the endowment and the tuition for this session. I think realistically that probably had to get set in motion a while ago. But what do you think about using a proposal along those lines as a stick in the event that the universities keep trying to increase tuition like they did right after you guys left town 2 years ago? My question for Mr. Vedder, just kind of a quick little bookkeeping one. You mentioned that UT and Texas A&M have gigantic, the two largest endowments in the country, and are in the middle of all sorts of national rankings, and I just kind of faded out there for a second. I wasn't sure. Were you talking about academics or football?
Both. I do the rankings, by the way, for Forbes magazine of colleges and universities. I do them. I'm the one that does them. So I have some familiarity with it. Texas looks very good in rankings, but do they look as good as they should look given the resources that they have? That was the question I was asking. And I have some doubts on that. And I think it is something that organizations such as TPPF and other organizations should be looking into. I did a study which Bill Powers tried to I won't begin to tell you what happened to me by the University of Texas. They can play pretty dirty at times. The University of Texas got very angry at me for doing some studies on the performance of faculty at the university. And I have been a professor for 52 years. I know all the games in the book. By the way, I have benefited enormously from taxpayers and from all this aid. I mean, I've taken extra trips to Europe. I've lived extremely well from the benefits of the Federal Student Financial Aid Program, for example. So the benefits don't go to the students. Absolutely right. You said that Ron said this. The benefits go to me and other administrators and all. The students are lost leaders in this. Texas is not getting quite their bang for the buck, I sense. And I saw an awful lot of examples of what might be called conspicuous consumption. A typical academic, I think there are immensely too many administrators, and I applaud you, Senator, for bringing attention to that. The big cost driver in recent years in universities is often expanding your bureaucracies. And there are more administrators over here at UT Austin than there are professors. I'll bet anyone $1,000 against $10 on that. It's absolutely true. Why?
Can I respond to that one question about the quality of UT? About 3 years ago, in the Washington Post, not here, but in the Washington Post, a study was released showing that with a nationwide college assessment test, which was apples to apples, the university's got the same test. UT finished in the 23rd percentile. In other words, 70%, 77% of the colleges academically, in terms of student learning, were higher. And I took this to some of the regents, and they said, yeah, we're rather embarrassed about that. But it was a fact. So you cannot academically at least say, because of that study, that it does extremely well academically. It may have changed by now, but that was about 3 years ago.
You asked a question about the endowment idea. There has been talk of going in and addressing endowment subjects and things by statute, but it's important to keep in mind that most of the elements we talk about relating to public university fund are set in Constitution, which is an entirely different process and concept. We talk about it all the time because we talk about, is the money being well spent? And Mr. Vedder talked about it in a very, very pointedly. And I guess I talked about it about a year ago when I was at Baylor University. And what I asserted then, and I assert now, was with that enormous amount of money, I believe the University of Texas system could probably have the tuition in all of its institutions from that money, and it would send shockwaves, I think, through higher education, and yet they choose not to. Not only do they choose not to, but to allow them to increase tuition, and that's a tough one to fathom. Yeah.
To add a point here in support of the senator's remarks about the growth of administration, as a former college professor and administrator, I can agree with the points that were made here. The money does not all of the money, to say the least, is going to students, nor is it going to faculty. Benjamin Ginsberg wrote a book in 2011, and some of you may be familiar with the article that he spun off from this. It's in the Washington Monthly, and it's titled "Administrators Ate My Tuition." we're focusing on Texas, and rightly so. We're in Texas, but this is not simply a Texas problem. All the other 49 states are battling with the same problem. And what Ginsberg showed in his nationwide study is this. 40 years ago, the faculty outnumbered administrators on campus by almost 2-1. Today, 40 years later, it's almost even. Right? That's where the growth in the budget has gone. Now, in the university's defense, some of that is in response to mandates, local, state, and federal, and compliance costs. But a study by the Goldwater Institute in 2010 found that the majority of the administrators, increases in the administrative budget were discretionary.
Let me, if I may add to that. So this discussion was premised on this question about tuition set-asides. And let's accept, as Dr. Trowbridge made the point, that there is a social good to provide the subsidy because of the particularly the two students that you made reference to. So if you accept that premise, and I do accept that there is a very high value for people to go to get advanced degrees. But on the other hand, the amount of money administration is just not administration. I think Tom Parley, part of that cost of child matter compliance, that's at the campus level.
Yes.
The amount of money that we're spending on system offices in the state of Texas would pay for the tuition set-asides.
Yes, that's right.
So there is a gargantuan misallocation of resources away from the student, away from faculty, away from campus, whether that might be facilities or other things, and toward administration that really has nothing to do with the day-to-day functioning of the campuses, has nothing to do with teaching, conferring degrees, or anything that goes is supposed to go on in the classroom. And that's really where the fundamental problem begins.
Agreed, John.
One of the things that we need to do is differentiate between administration and cost of operation. Universities is large industries, and that's what they are. You mentioned A&M is going to be 90,000 students. A lot of the people that hire that are non-instructional are also the people who have to maintain environmental controls and maintain grounds and things like that. We shouldn't confuse that with those that are really administrators and non-instructional. But I would make the case in using the Texas model that an awful lot of money that goes to make some of those industrial plants, if you will, much bigger, expansive, and require more cost, would be better spent at areas where incrementally you could accommodate more instruction for less money. In this case, in my district, University of Texas Permian Basin, West Texas A&M, same amount of money, you could get more bang for your buck investing that enormous amount of money for campus growth in some of those institutions than you can in the flagships. And let's include University of Texas, Tyler, UT, RGV, on and on. It's a question of where you spend the money sometimes, not just how.
Yes, and just to add to your point, Senator, we find ourselves, and for good reasons, talking always about the two flagships. The two flagships together, their undergraduate population is about 7% of the total college-going population in Texas. Our concern, and I think we hear this from all four panelists, is what about the other 93%? Yes, sir, in the back.
I'd like to know your thoughts on set-aside and other scholarships for illegal aliens. And John Caliandro or anybody else who'd like to speak about that subject.
Well, I take this point of view. There are many students that are attending our institutions of higher education that are not legal residents of the United States. However, many of them fall in the category of having been brought here as children, have met all the requirements to graduate from a Texas public high school, have all the requirements to go to an institution of higher education, and I'm not sure that my point of view, that those students in those circumstances ought to be deprived of the opportunity to access those institutions or all the benefits thereof.
Any other questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
There was a comment made earlier. We're starting to liken this to talking about Medicaid. And what I hear most of this talk about is where's the revenues going to come from? I was very involved philanthropically and alumni association on one of the better private schools. And a very good friend of mine, he was a development director. So we don't run these schools anymore. The professors run the schools. And when I, in fact, they kept raising the level scholastically to even get in. I said, well, where's the good people? Just good old solid people go. He said, we're not worried about that anymore. The professors want to raise the bar, how many journals they've published and this and that, and how few hours they have to teach because somebody else is going to do it for them, and so on. Well, I don't believe we're going to solve this problem unless we direct some approaches we're trying to do with Medicaid, is we have to do a more efficient job of delivering the product. We need to get the bang for the bucks. It, you know, are we trying to put a crown on the school, or are we trying to teach kids? And I sometimes am concerned that it's the first and not the second. How do we measure output as against cost? And right now, and I don't know anything about this, I'm just telling you what I'm just thinking. Right now, we don't have any way to control the cost. And they keep raising it up and raising it up and raising it up. And they raise tuitions and so on. And I mean, I was implored to hear that our wonderful university here is in the bottom 23%.
Now, but that's among peer institutions.
Well, okay. Okay. I'm just saying that when you have that kind of endowment, and all you can do is get to 23% at the bottom 23%, what the heck is wrong? Now, is what I'm saying make any sense at all?
No, it's too simplistic to say that because so much of that endowment is being diverted from instructional purposes to other things, but that's still one of the elements. Clearly.
Can I liken this problem to something like what we're addressing with Medicaid?
I would have to defer that one to Mr. Caliendo, who is the expert.
Okay, well, and by that, then, we don't have a way to measure what we're getting for the dollars we're spending.
Yeah, it is true. What is the bottom line in higher education? How do you know UT had a good year last year or a bad year? We know about the football team. We know about the basketball team. And one reason we pay coaches a lot is we can measure their performance, and we can measure it very accurately, and there's also commercial value associated with it. How do we know whether the English department is teaching anything? How do we know whether seniors know more than freshmen? We're in the knowledge business. We're in the business of measuring knowledge. Yet the one kind of knowledge that we don't want to measure is what goes on in our own schools. Why are, you know, do seniors know more than freshmen? There was one survey done a number of years ago that I remember for the Intercollegiate Studies Institute or one of the tests. The average Yale graduate in the senior year knew less basic facts about civic virtue and civic literacy than the average freshman at Yale. They lost knowledge while at Yale. They became dumber at Yale every year they were there. Now, I don't believe that is really the case.
Well, we
don't know how to measure.
I went to Dartmouth, and it is true.
Oh, shit. Excuse me. Dartmouth's worse. I've been in Hanover quite a few times.
I'm sure you're welcome back.
Where are the animal? It's the Animal House University.
Yes, sir.
We're not going to stop this session.
You had a question?
In reference, Mr. Caliandro, to your statement about the, alien.
Right.
That, you know, we need to help them because it isn't their fault that they were born by parents that did something illegal. Well, my question to you is, it wasn't me that chose to be raised by poor tenant farmers that had no education. So why wouldn't it be fair that you reimburse my tuition because it'll be fair?
I think I was answering the question more broadly than that, than as a specific debates about tuition subsidies and access to the Texas grant program. I would say this. I don't think that there's any obstacle with taking another look at the policy that was put in place in 2001, which was voted on with two dissenting votes in the entire Texas legislature, and that bill signed into law by a Republican governor. Now, having said that, I would suggest to you that the bigger issue that's worthy of debate is access to the institutions by out-of-state and international students. In my opinion, particularly the flagship institutions and their affiliates are here to ostensibly for the benefit of the residents of the state of Texas. It is an enormous income stream for the universities to accept international students and out-of-state students. So as a consequence, I think the issue is less about, in my view, the Texas resident that happens to be illegal, who, by the way, the U.S. Supreme Court said, at least K through 12, we have to educate them. So I don't see any particular reason why, if we're educating them K through 12, that we should say you can't go to university. And then number two, but if the universities are here to benefit the residents of the state, why is 25% of the population in a lot of these campuses international students? At least that illegal who was brought here as a three-year-old is a Texas resident whose parents are paying taxes either through property or sales tax. Yes, ma'am. They pay taxes. Probably if they're buying goods and services in the state of Texas. That goes to general revenue, which goes to support the institutions.
Unless they're living in Section 8 housing.
Yes. I'm afraid that will have to be the last word. We're out of time. Please join me again in thanking our panelists. Thank you.